If that happens to you at Subway and you don't choose the fucking moon, then I'm going to come down on you so hard. I want to see what happens.
Hello, everyone. You're currently listening to House of Bards. I'm Beth, and this is Alex.
Yes, hello.
Today's topic, we figured if we were going to do one about technology versus magic, and we've already done an episode on technology, we should probably do one solely on magic.
That seems sensible.
This is the Magic Podcast.
Mm-hmm. Not like a podcast about Magic, the Gathering. I believe those exist. I don't currently run one, and I would be sketchy about doing so. I think in one of the recordings I advocated that you should run Athreos, God of the Dead, before he rotates out of standard, but then that got cut, so I will say it again. You should do that, because he's a pretty neat card, he's very well costed, and he really annoys your opponent. Anyway, so magic then.
We're talking about magic in the context of your world, whatever that may be, whether it be...
Yeah. And also possibly your system. Magic is kind of stranger than technology in this particular sense because it's not just the world that's going to be defining what is and isn't available. You've also got the system to contend with, which has its own ideas of what magic should do and how it should work.
Which, in some ways, is good because it kind of takes a lot of the, I guess, technical side of magic and the more complicated thinky bits of magic, and it leaves you with just the fun world-building bits of magic, which, from one perspective, unless you, like, read something in the manual and you're like, fuck that shit, I'm going to do this instead, if you're so inclined.
Yeah, it's kind of a delicately balanced system, which means that there's not as much of that that you can really do without messing it up as you might like. Which is an issue. I suppose that's why there are a number of different systems with a number of different ways for magic to work. But generally, at least in my experience of role-playing systems, D&D's Vancian magic is considered very generous. So other systems will often scale back the ability of player characters to interact with magic.
Yeah.
So I have not seen a huge number of systems go the other way, possibly because it's difficult to manage.
Yeah.
So... magic, then.
Magic. We have some 12 questions to ask yourself about your magic system that we're going to go through. These were written by, I'm sorry if I get your name wrong, Met Ivy Harrison, and she's a children's writer. I'll see if I can get the link to this particular blog post in the description of the YouTube video if I can. You probably have seen this. There are 12 questions. Not all of these are going to be relevant to every world. Certainly ones without magic. These are all completely fucking irrelevant. So, you might as well go do something. Unless you really love us, you might as well go do something else during this podcast. If, your main game doesn't have any magic in it. Although, you know, we like you being here.
Yeah.
I like you being here.
Yeah, I will attempt to answer these questions as Beth asks them with respect to Dawnsomber, my world, but I encourage you to think about your world and how these questions might pertain to it. Mm. If indeed it does have magic, and, well, even if it doesn't have magic, why not?
You know? Yeah, have a bit of fun.
There are a decent number of reasons, but maybe you will come up with them when you just think about these questions.
Yeah. So, question A. How is it learned and executed?
Okay, I think we're getting to the meat of the matter almost immediately there. I am a computer science student, and I have been for, coming up for 3 years now. I've definitely had an interest longer than that. In Dawnsomber, magic is very similar to open source programming in its social structure and in the way that it's learned. Anybody can learn magic, but not everybody does. In fact, a fairly large number of people don't. Because it's considered too complicated, even if most people can recognize the, general benefits of being able to do it. It's seen as complex and just like a walled garden, essentially, that it really isn't. But it's learned by learning of a number of simple principles about how the arcane moves and interacts with living things and non-living things and the space around you, and then defining the terms in a language, number of different magical languages, just so there are a number of different programming languages that can all do certain different things, and using that language as a binding vector for the ability to exert control over the arcane, if that makes any sense.
I get that. That sort of is an up. Anyone can do it, but not everybody can do it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it's there's a lot of people who believe that it's not for them, or who will dabble in it a little bit, but they'll never really get past like a basic and pretty mana leaky spell for something fairly domestic that you might do in a tutorial.
I mean, there are other ways around this. So I know in my particular fantasy world, it's something you go to school for. It's something you're genetically predisposed to. Approximately 20% of the human population can learn magic, and nobody else has that ability apart from elves and other, like, orcs can learn magic and stuff. But anyway,
Yeah,
you know.
that's another way that you can take it, and there's a number of fantasy worlds that I see that do favor that. I suppose right on the far end of the spectrum you have like Tolkien, where there's five Istari and that's it, honestly. I mean, there's magic that's used and done by other beings in The Lord of the Rings,
We'll get to those questions later,
but
Alex, don't worry, but
But yeah, it's like it's incredibly restricted. There's only a certain number of beings who can even do it, and it's ridiculously small, and they're all like already masterful. There isn't really any learning involved.
How is it accessed? Which I presume is how does one use magic physically? Is I presume that's what that question means.
How is it accessed?
You know, do you tap into the mana of the world, or?
Well, there's a quote from Douglas Adams' Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency, which I have mentioned on the podcast before in episode
You have.
3. You should check it out. It's a very good book, and the BBC radio drama that was made of it is incredibly good and has Billy Boyd in it. But there's a quote where Professor Chronotis speaks of his abacus, which can do something a bit special, and says that it basically understands the way he uses it. And that's kind of the way that I envision magic working in Dawnsombra, in that you have all of these magic programming languages, if you will, which have been defined by a certain person. So you're able to sort of like just mentally tap into the arcane background magic, and then when you define a magical language, you are basically just like defining a system by which the magic will work with you. And then if you learn somebody else's language, then that magic language works because that becomes a component part of how you understand magic working. Sorcerers are basically calling root processor functions. Sorcerers never get to the point where they actually start like structuring the way that they relate to magic. They just have a series of like cognitive systems by which they know how to do specific things, and then they just run those whenever they need to cast a spell, which is much more direct and requires a lot less rigmarole, but obviously is much more dangerous.
I've always wondered about bards in your universe and how they work, because bards are bards in fifth, like bards in Dungeons and Dragons. They're almost not real spellcasters. They're a bit like paladins. They're a bit weird in that
Well,
aspect.
bards interact with the arcane by weaving music. And the thing about music is that, unlike other kinds of magic, well, unlike wizardry magic, the spell happens alongside the music. So bards are kind of like scripters, if you like, in the, well, not even scripters, it's like just in time programming, in that the compilation is happening as the song is being played, Which means that bards can very quickly change their song in order to do something different. But they run into a problem where there's not as much of the actual depth of the actual meat of the arcane available to them because they're just scripting off the top. So bards might be the equivalent of something using JavaScript, something like that. Bards are UI designers, essentially.
Okay, that makes sense,
Yeah, and of course that kind of works because music is one of the most accessible forms of magic to like a general arcanophobic populace. In the music is the most easily understandable because the rest of it you have like scrolls and spell books that are written in magical languages, and if you don't know those, it's going to be a bit confusing. Or powers that you have to just access base arcana, but you don't really understand. So music is by far the most understandable, even if it's not necessarily any more accessible to people who haven't taken the time to actually learn how to do the magic.
Are you ready for the next question?
Did you have an answer for that? Does it work differently in your world?
I mean, I guess they kind of tap into the natural magic of like the world, if that makes sense. We're going a bit weird now, but people in the world of 2 Earth are either sun powered or moon powered, and you get your cosmic magical energy either from the sun or the moon, and that is how you are able to cast magic.
Yeah, okay. You know,
Yeah, that's
sun and the
just
moon.
sun and the moon. It's just how it happens. There aren't any like benefits from cast if you're a moon powered person casting magic at night or in the day, because you just soak up whatever natural energy is around. As it's magic is background radiation, and you are tapping into that background radiation to do things.
It seems we're
It is.
both a fan of magic as background radiation.
You know, but in this context, you are using the background radiation to like form it into something and get it to do something, whether it's to heal someone or cause a fireball or turn someone into an animal or to teleport.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, as I mentioned in the first episode, I'm a big fan of employing concepts that were originally used to patch a wound to do something else to make them more legit. So, magic acting as, or at least arcane magic acting as background radiation has other implications in Dawn Sombra. Like, some of them where it is in fact acting very much like actual background radiation, like being near too much of it concentrated in one place is a bad idea because horrible things can happen to you. But like yeah, the sun of them. I think it's even sanctified in the book that like druids can get the moon
The moon.
as like one of their sources of power. Like they can either choose one of a bunch of like not domains, that kind of thing of like druid focuses or the
The
moon.
moon.
And it's not even like the moon focus, it's just the moon is the alternative to all of those choices. I just love like the idea that there could be a whole slew of other sets of neatly arranged choices or the moon.
The moon.
Like you got a subway and they're like, what would you like? And I'm like, well, what do you got? And I'm like, well, we've got all you could choose a sandwich with all of these ingredients on it, or the moon. And I'm like, do I get to eat the moon? And they're like, no, the moon is just an alternative to that choice. I don't understand what you mean. And they're like, well, you evidently haven't understood the rules properly then. That's a surreal experience, I imagine, happening at Subway, justified by 5th edition Dungeons and Dragons.
If that does happen to you at Subway, you should probably put in a complaint if they've
If that happens to you at Subway and you don't choose the fucking moon, then I'm gonna come down on you so hard. I wanna see what happens.
One day I'm gonna work at Subway and I'm gonna do that.
And then
One
you'll get
day,
fired.
probably. Yeah, I get fired.
What's the next question?
Does magic have a will of its own?
Well, the arcane magic, no. The old magic at least did, and possibly still does. Because the old magic is like the same thing as the old gods. Like the old gods were this sort of like continuous fluid material that also constituted the old magic. So Yes, that has a mind of its own. The arcane, there's a certain amount of understanding that can be achieved, but it's not really like sentient or anything. It's more that it's just very reactive. It's maybe nervous, if that makes sense. Like a jellyfish, but it's not really a living thing.
Yeah.
What about you?
I haven't really considered this question that much because it's such a weird question. I think ultimately, if people have a will of its own, magical people have a will of their own, then magic has a will of its own. It's more of a philosophical question in this universe. It's like, does magic have a will of its own? Well, don't free people, by definition, have a will of their own, and therefore the magic within them has a will of its own? I suppose, in terms of wild magic sorcerers, yeah, kind of,
I
because they're
think, like,
definitely not doing that, like.
I think it could be understood that a large number of the vectors by which magic can be accessed, at least in like more modern versions of D&D, make it clear that at least some of those sources have minds of their own.
Yeah.
Warlocks in particular, like they actually have patrons who do
Oh, yeah.
definitely have minds of their own, but like
Yeah.
wild magic sorcerers, it is implied that wild magic is volatile in a way that suggests some kind of intelligence.
Yeah. I think that's, I mean, definitely fae have a will of their own, and they are extremely magical beings, and possibly where magic comes from. And fae are a big bit of the world of Two Earth. So you could argue that they are by proxy magic in its human form, having their own will. So maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. I'll have to think about that one.
All right. What's next?
Is it restricted in space and time?
This is a really weird question. I
It is a
don't
really
know
weird
what it
question.
means.
I mean, surely if you can teleport, if you have any spells that allow you to teleport, and if you have any spells that allow you to travel in time, the answer is no. No.
There is not currently any magic that can be used to travel in time, but that does not mean that spells to that effect or divine powers such might not one day be invented. As for space, teleporting in space is possible. Limited planar shifting is possible, and indeed there can exist a group of beings who can just planar shift at will. So in that sense, they're not really restricted in space. But in terms of can magic affect things that we might consider to be outside our understanding of space and time, I don't know if the canon of the setting even confirms that such things are a reality. So that's kind of meaningless. And also, possibly the old magic might, but the arcane just sort of exists. It quantifies itself with its relationship to reality and, to an extent, the exoplanes, so it is restricted in space in that sense.
I think in Two Earth, definitely not by space. I mean, you can travel to parallel dimensions in Two Earth if you so will it, and you find magic strong enough, you can travel to a parallel universe. But I think in time, I think it is restricted in time because nothing allows you to turn back time or turn forward time or pause time even. So I think it's not restricted in space, but in time it would be. Although if there was science in Two Earth that could stop time or time travel, then
If
yes, that's fine.
your setting has magic that can predict the future, does that mean it's restricted in time?
Oh, that's a good point.
I mean, obviously it's still restricted, but it's not like
Yeah.
completely restricted.
That's a good question, and I don't know the answer to it because there's definitely fortune telling and,
I don't know, is
predicting the
there
future.
prophecy? And like a lot of times people in Dawn Sombra do predict the future, but they generally do it the way that like
Yeah.
real people and like economists and climatologists and statisticians and whatever in real life would predict the future by looking at current trends or using information that only they are privy to and extrapolating future events based on that, rather than actually magically looking into the future.
I'm not sure on this answer. If you think that predicting the future constitutes as breaking the limits of time of what
Like
we understand
magically
it to be.
predicting the future with a certain degree of accuracy, like prophecy, not just the shit that real mathematicians do every day.
If you think that that definitely like counts as time magic or time traveling, then comment. because I'm genuinely not sure on the answer of that.
Or you can contact one of us. We'll give you the contact details at the end of the podcast if you don't
Yeah.
remember.
We are not sure is the answer to
Yeah,
that
I don't
question.
know. It's an interesting question, I think.
Yeah.
But what is the next one?
What does available magic do? What can magic do, essentially?
Well, magic can do quite a lot of things.
Hmm.
It's possibly more useful to like answer this question in terms of what magic definitely can't do.
That's coming up later.
Ah, well, what can magic do? Well, you understand it in Dungeons and Dragons, the schools of magic.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of things that magic can do, and there are a lot of different types of magic. Like, I have two canonized already before you even get to like divine magic and druidic magic and music as magic, which is largely arcane, but whatever. Like, it can do a lot of things. It can cause harm to people, it can heal people, it can, to an extent, bring people back from the light, from the dead under like certain circumstances. It can change the physical properties of matter. It can provide information that the caster would not otherwise be able to obtain to the caster and their allies. It can affect the minds of other beings. It can cause illusions of things that aren't really there. There's a whole load of things that it can do,
Yeah.
and it's really only limited by your imagination in canon. Obviously, somebody has to write every new spell, which leads to an interesting situation that I might speak of later if there isn't a question that brings it up.
Yeah. I think my answer would be the same. We're gonna have to really get to what can't it do in order to explain really what can it do, because magic can do a lot in this world, but it can't do everything, or it can do most. Like, I've had to kind of form it to Dungeons and Dragons rules somehow, but I'll explain how I've done that in a bit.
Really, honestly, in a setting like this, you're generally restricted to Dungeons and Dragons rules unless you want to get rid of magic entirely.
Yeah.
With some exceptions, like I do have certain house rules about certain types of magic that I
Yeah.
carry through to a certain extent.
Yeah. But I think I've got a similar. It can do a great deal of things.
Yeah, it's the process by which sapient beings express their will upon reality,
Yeah.
beyond their like physical abilities.
Yeah. This one's a bit of a weird one. How does it relate to the character plot and theme of the book? So I guess you could kind of take this as how does magic relate to the theme of the setting, rather?
Quite a lot and not at all.
Yeah.
Like, the old magic is incredibly important, and considerably more powerful than the arcane, but also works in a completely different way, and that drives a lot of the story behind elvish characters in Dawnsombra and also the Elven Empire, and the heritage available on the Isle of Bells as well. Like, pretty much the whole reason it's called the Sombre, Dawnsombra, the Sombre Dawn, is because time is basically measured from, well, not time, history. Their year zero, if you like, is measured from the point when the old gods disappeared, because that's when the souring happened and elves found they couldn't use the old magic anymore, and it was a complete shift in the way that their society worked. Most say for the worst. Some who are privy to information that they might not normally have say possibly for the better. So, in that sense, like, the old magic is incredibly important to the history of the setting and as to like why everything even exists in the first place. And divine magic as well is also pretty important because the gods do a whole lot of shit. Arcane magic is only important in the sense that it is technically democratized magic, but as I've already explained, not everybody takes advantage of that, so it's really just another form of magic. But the fact that anybody could like pick up a paper and pen and like have a go is probably a driving force behind the large number of magically inclined amateurs who have the potential to become adventurers.
I think in my setting, obviously, because this is a setting that I'm going to use in a book, and the book themes are a bit more different to the themes of the setting. So I won't talk that much about the book, but essentially it's the idea of only certain people are born with innate abilities, it's a lot like how you get kids really young and you call them prodigies and genius, and then they kind of grow up with that stigma attached to them.
Oh
And it's
yeah, man, I know that.
and that's kind of the theme of that. It's about, what do you do when, you've been raised as this wunderkind, and then suddenly you're in school with a bunch of these wunderkinds, and you're all similarly kind of in the same ballpark. Maybe some of you are better at magic than others, and maybe some of you are better at different kinds of magic. But what do you do when you realize that A, you're not that special, or B, you're kind of okay at what you do, but you're not the prodigy and genius darling that everyone thought you were, and then how do you deal with that?
You get really, really, really good at memory charms, and then you go around the world finding people who have done more interesting things than you do, and you steal their stories and sell them for thousands. Obviously.
I guess that's one answer.
And then you get knocked out by some children, but you don't get killed, so that's good.
But that's the kind of answer of, what do you do when, it's quite a deep question, because the book has lots of questions about, growing up and, going from school into the adult world and what you do when you do that. And it's about power and responsibility and becoming your own person and lots of scary things. The book's about becoming a grown up, essentially.
Well, I think that's a good parallel. I think that's probably actually one of the reasons why Harry Potter works so well, is that like putting this parallel down between gaining some kind of superhuman power and coming into adulthood is they're very closely they mirror each other, because when you do become an adult, there are a large number of powers and abilities that you start coming into very naturally, almost so that you don't notice, but which you then see that you now have, which you previously didn't. Like, there's a huge amount of personal responsibility that you're able to shoulder, and a large amount more power than that you would wield than if you were a child, like both fiscally and in terms of self-determination and stuff like that, which is weird to think about when you actually notice it.
Which, if anybody has ever gotten a paycheck and you've looked at the paycheck, from your job or whatever, or any bit of money you've gotten that requires you getting a paycheck, and you've went, I could go and spend this all on Haribo sour mix right now.
I
I could,
shouldn't, and I
I
won't,
shouldn't,
but
but
I
I
could.
could. Or getting a McDonald's and being like, wait a minute, I can eat my ice cream first. I don't have to eat the burger and chips first, and you eat the ice cream first. It's that kind of like, whoa, I'm an adult now. And that kind of learning stage where you kind of go, okay, next paycheck, I won't spend this all on Haribo sour mix.
I did not
Not
have
that
that
I've ever.
experience with my first paycheck because I am doing an internship for university and living on my own, and I need to pay rent immediately. But that's another thing. I paid rent. I am like powering my own accommodation and like actual living, which, you know, 3 years ago I wouldn't be doing. So it's definitely a recipe for success, I think, at least to a certain extent, to just, you know, actually parallel that to a young adult actually gaining superhuman powers, whether they be magic or becoming some kind of superhero or supervillain.
But
And that's probably why that's so successful, because that market is, that demographic is very open to ideas of people they can relate to gaining powers and abilities that they did not previously have.
But again, it's mixed in with ideas of, especially the magic side of it, the magical mage character, and it has to kind of be like, all my life I've been told that I was this wonderful prodigy genius, but I'm actually not really that good at this. There are people who are way better at me than this because they've been doing it way longer than me, or they're just more talented at it than me. And it's about, what do you do when. But I think in terms of what the players are going to have to be stifled with, if you're a magic user player in my world, be prepared to answer a lot of questions about the responsibility you have and the kind of prodigy stigma attached to you, unless you're Alex's character, in which way you've completely convened all that by becoming a fucking pirate. What is the cost of magic?
Like, energy? Honestly?
I mean, yeah.
Time? There isn't a huge amount of cost.
No.
It's dangerous. That could be considered a cost, but there's not a huge... You don't really need a cost when the thing that's preventing the use of magic by a lot of people is just apathy and misunderstanding. That's
yeah.
the driving force. I mean, it mirrors the real world. It mirrors the way that I've modeled everything off programming as a concept. Yeah, that's the reason why. So there doesn't really need to be a huge amount of cost. I mean, obviously, if there are flaws in a language that you've written to interact with magic and you run up against those flaws in a spell that you're writing, the spell will become exponentially more dangerous.
Yeah.
So that's a cost, I suppose.
I mean, I think as well, if you go by purely, you want to go pure rule book guidelines for Dungeons & Dragons, you have stuff like the spell components. But not everybody does that, and I certainly don't do that.
Man.
Fuck that, yeah. But if you want to do that, that would be a cost, therefore. I think in Two Earth, it's energy and time, generally, for most magic. The price that warlocks pay is a bit bigger because they have to offer their, you know, eternal immortal soul to their, you know, patron, essentially, and all that entails. So if you are a specific person who I'm thinking of, you've offered your eternal immortal soul to this demon of, you know, knowledge, and you've been changed physically by it because of it. And it's a great, you know, cost to them physically, but also in the afterlife, they will pay for it because that's not what you're meant to do with your soul. You aren't meant to bargain it off to demons. That's a bad thing to do.
Sure, most of you know how Faustus works.
Yeah. but, I mean, other than just, like, getting tired when you use too much magic in one day, which Dungeons & Dragons supports...
Yeah, that's a pretty big part of Vancian magic as it's modelled in pretty much all versions of Dungeons & Dragons.
Yeah, the more experienced you are as a magic user, the less rest you have to take and the more magic you can use.
Yeah, well, mainly the more magic you can use. Like,
the
more capacity of magic you have within between frequent rests.
Yeah.
So presumably the less time and the less memory your rituals will take.
I mean, in the book, mages have to eat a lot as well. But that, I can't really find a way to put that into Dungeons & Dragons, but mages eat a lot.
It makes sense, yeah.
Replenish the energy, yeah.
I think in Dawn some of that wouldn't really happen just because of the way that magic actually works. Like, it's not really... Like, you do use your energy, but you only really use your energy to, like, actually key into the arcane. And then it does all the work from that point onwards. So there isn't a huge amount of need for, like, actually... using your own magic, using your own energy to expend on magic.
Yeah. But, you know, that's the cost of magic. And obviously, we'll discuss this in a bit, but any magic that revolves bringing someone back from the dead is incredibly costly, especially if they've been dead for a while.
I also have massive restrictions on bringing people back from the dead. Is there a question that actually pertains to that?
What can it not do?
What can magic in Dawn Summer not do? Magic in Dawn Summer cannot allow a person to travel through time, currently.
Yeah.
Magic in Dawn Summer cannot allow a person to... Well, hang on. Arcane magic in Dawn Summer cannot currently allow a person to travel to an exoplane that they are not aware of and don't have a reasonably good idea of the nature of. So, basically, plane shifting at will is restricted to beings who relate to the old magic. If you're in, you know, if you're using the arcane, then you generally have to know about the plane that you want to go to, and you have to know like what's there and kind of what it looks like as well before you can even try and make an attempt. Divine magic is kind of different in that, you know, obviously gods find it very easy to transport you to their plane, but would find it very difficult to transport you to a plane like made by another being. Although not impossible, because it has happened. It also has massive restrictions on bringing people back from the dead, and the way that healing magic works in relation to dead people is also... Okay, so the rules I have for resurrection. because when I was drafting this out, I wanted Resurrection to be something that was possible in Dawnsomber, but not something that players would take for granted, which means that there are some pretty big restrictions on what can and can't be done and under what conditions. So I took this idea from the way that a poison in second edition worked, but basically, if you die and then you're brought back to life, and when you're brought back to life, the thing that was happening to your body that caused you to die is still happening to it, you just instantly die again. For instance, if you don't have any blood and somebody brings you back to life, you have, like, a cleric next to you will have one action to cure you and make you have blood again, otherwise you're just gonna die. Like, basically, non-divine resurrection magic cannot heal significant wounds. The other thing is that the natural effects of dying are... Basically, healing magic doesn't work on corpses, and healing magic doesn't work... Well, healing magic does work, but works at a very reduced power on injuries that were sustained while a body was dead. So if you get your stomach cut open, then a cleric could cure wounds you and it will be fine. Like, it'll just heal right up, it'll be absolutely grand. If you die and somebody slits your stomach open and then you're brought back to life and you get healed, like, it's gonna be fine, but you're gonna have a massive scar all the way up your abdomen basically forever. Because and that also applies to things like rigor mortis and, like, basically, there's a whole set of rules for, like, how your core ability scores start going down based on the effects of decay and rigor mortis. Like, after a certain number of hours, you start losing dex points because your limbs start to go stiff, and you lose int and whiz points when, you know, brain degradation sets in, and you can't get those back. Like, nothing short of divine intervention can fix that. So, basically, what this comes down to is that although resurrection is possible, it is treated like an emergency medical procedure. It's... you have to be really, really close to somebody who can achieve it, and can achieve it quickly. And if it's done cheaply, like in the case of, I can't remember if it's Spare the Dying, or a slightly more powerful spell that's like the one-shot, incredibly specific, just proper resurrect... that will take a massive toll on the caster. I have a cleric in my game who has whitened her hair, a large amount of it, significantly by bringing people back from the grave, and is now considering not doing that as frequently, because she's taking years off the end of her life. What else can it do? Basically, because magic is, like, formatted off open source software, the more complicated you... the thing that you want a spell to do is, the less likely somebody has invented a spell that can do it. So this is... the fun thing is that because that's how inventing spells works, and because everybody can do that also, you'll generally find that the more complicated an existing spell is, the fewer ways there are to do it. Like, you have a very, very simple spell at the bottom, like Magic Missile. There are hundreds of thousands of subtly different ways to cast Magic Missile in Dawnsomber. But if we think about, like, a very, very powerful spell, like, what's a really, really powerful spell in 5th edition? I don't think Power Word Kill's that powerful anymore.
I think, it is. I think it is.
Do you have the book there?
I've got the book right here.
Alright, well, give me the name of a 9th level spell. Preferably something that wizards can cast.
Okay. I'm gonna find the spell section. Blah, 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 blah. Wizards, 9th level. Time Stop, or Power Word Kill.
Oh, Power Word Kill is that powerful. Well, alright, so proper Power Word Kill is basically one spell. Like, there's only one way to do that. Maybe, I think, for something as simple as, like, saying a word to kill somebody, there might be two or three ways to do it. But really, only the best magicians have actually come up with a sound, non-mana-leaking way to cast Power Lord Kill. And this is the thing, like, the major effect of, like, this being more than just fluff is that if you treat magic like programming, one of the major effects is that almost all spell scrolls become automatically worthless because most magic is open source, and because the scrolls aren't really consumed when they're copied, because that does not make any fucking sense. Why would that happen? Then it's like, basically the only way that you can make a magic scroll worth anything is if it's an incredibly powerful spell that only one person has invented, and you either are that one person or are in league with that one person, and you are restricting public access to that spell. By copying the record of the spell, you are reducing its value. And that is the really fun thing, I think, because of course it means that most of the spells discovered by by parties are of no value whatsoever unless they are copied to a mage's spellbook. Maybe if somebody was having a problem with programming a particular spell, then you could just be like, "Hey, I've got the answer." But then you're terrible. Don't do that. Also, don't do that in real life in the thing that this is all a metaphor for, please. Always, always, always ask, "What have you tried?" So yeah, it's that's the major effect. So magic is a work in progress, basically. I got a bit off topic there, but that's the main point, is that there are going to be things that are difficult to do with magic just because not a lot of people have invented them yet.
I think in my world, it can never bring back someone from the dead perfectly. And this is specifically for resurrection. Like, reincarnation kind of works because you're putting someone's essence into a new body. So it kind of works. There's like a payoff there. Like, yeah, you're not back perfect anywhere because you're a different thing. And revivify doesn't really count because I count that as like, resuscitation, essentially. But reincarnation, bringing back, not, sorry, resurrection, bringing someone back from the dead isn't always going to work out the way that people think it works out. And the person is always like, depending on how long that person's been dead as well, they're going to know stuff about the afterlife and what it entails that living people shouldn't know about. And they're always going to want to go back to being dead. And they're always going to want to go back to their own spiritual afterlife journey. Like, they're always going to be like, "Why did you bring me back? I was perfectly content." Unless, of course, they weren't. But if they weren't, they're a revenant and have
Or a
unfinished
ghost,
business.
right?
Well, yeah, but you're not going to get that person back perfect because they've done something different now and they've experienced something else and they've changed as a person. And not only have they changed as a person, but they've experienced something that no living being can ever really experience. So if you resurrect someone, you are disrupting them on that journey, and they're always going to want to go back and return to that journey. So
There's a lot of stories that explore, like, potentially terrible consequences of interacting with people who have been dead. I believe that there's a film with Olivia Wilde in it coming out pretty soon about, like, resurrecting people and how that goes really, really badly. It might be Olivia Wilde, it might be somebody else.
But
Science fiction film, horror film, I don't know.
I was really interested in that idea because J.K. Rowling kind of brought it up a little bit in the last kind of few Harry Potter books, but she never really expanded that much on it. Whereas it's, quite.
Harry's, like, experience of the station platform in the afterlife is not honestly all that traumatic.
No,
It
it's not.
seems potentially pleasant, but also kind of horrifying, but it's generally framed in a way that we can understand as being a conceptual physical space that works with many of the same rules that we've come to understand, either in the real world or in the way that we experience dreams. So I don't know if that's an I incredibly extreme example.
mean, you could argue in Harry Potter that's like limbo, and because he's not really dead, it's sort of
There is
like,
some implication that way, yes.
Whereas, when he uses the ring and he brings back his, godparent and, well, Remus kind of counts as a godparent as well, and his parents, they kind of have this conversation about him. And I know that the story of the three brothers goes into quite a bit of detail about what happens when you bring back someone from the dead with the ring, and that she doesn't quite, she hasn't came back right, it's not a perfect resurrection. and she's like always sort of quite forlorn and
Yeah.
this sort of, if you bring back someone from the dead, they are different, and there are people in the Earth of World of Two Earth that have brought back people from the dead, and they generally keep it a secret because they're not supposed to have brought back people from the dead, because you don't do that. That's not a right thing to do. It's not ethical, and you're essentially keeping someone here against their will when they've got more important shit to do. Anyway, but that is, what that's essentially something it can't do in this universe. And it's time travel, as we've mentioned, but it, resurrecting someone
Of
is.
course, the question is, what do you consider time stop to be? Because you could see that as time manipulation,
I
or you
mean,
could see it as like ability manipulation of a specific being. Like, are you just going so fast that it
it's like,
seems like time has stopped, or
yes, that's what
has
it
time
is. You're
actually
going
stopped?
so fast, it's like time has stopped. That's what it is. It's not that you've stopped time.
Yeah, that's. I
Just
think
to
that's
save me a
generally
bit of
layout.
grief later on, that's what it's like.
Yeah, I'm going with that as well. It
Yeah.
reduces the amount of like, no, there's not any really any time travel except this one time.
Yeah. But yeah, like, you can't really bring. I mean, you can get. There are other ways of getting around bringing back people from the dead. Like, you can bring people back as zombies and as flesh constructs, but that's not bringing back someone perfect either. That's essentially.
With enough foresight, you could bring them back as like a vampire or a
See,
lich.
even vampires don't quite work that way because they're undead. Undead work differently because it's essentially their soul is still trapped in their body for whatever reason. Yeah, look, like, if you're raising the dead, you've kind of crossed the moral event horizon in, like, the morals of the universe. I know death clerics can do it, but know that it is against your character's religion to do so, to raise the dead. I just want you to know that. How long does magic last?
Well, that depends what spell you cast.
Same,
And
yeah.
it also depends on the ambient arcane magic presence and on the speed at which the long-term effect of a spell is enacted and on whether the spell mana leaks or not. Like, permanent enchantment's definitely a thing that can be set up.
Definitely thing.
Not really healthy to do, advised against unless you really have to, but can be done just by like looping the syntax of your spell. And the magical effects of there being too much arcane magic around can extend or enhance normal spells. But really, it does depend on the spell. Like,
Yeah.
generally, refer to the casting time and the duration of the spell in the player's handbook, and so long as I, as the DM, approve of it, that's cool. If you want to invent new spells, we can come to some agreement about that as well.
I think in Two Earth, like, if you kill the person casting the spell, like, any spell they're casting at that point will immediately end. As enchanted objects are a bit different. If you destroy the enchanted object, then obviously the enchantment on that ends. Although, woe be told to you who try to destroy a ring of indestructibility, which is a long and laborious folk tale that perhaps the denizens of the world and my players may hear
If it's a
one
ring
time.
of indestructibility, I presume that means the wearer of the ring becomes indestructible, not the ring itself.
Well, see, the person becomes indestructible, but the ring by proxy is indestructible because of its indestructibility charm.
So you can destroy it,
As
but
long as you
it's
remove the
difficult.
indestructibility charm, but the indestructibility charm itself is indestructible. It's an indestructible paradox. It's just indestructible charms on top of indestructible
Oh dear.
charms.
Can you exile it instead?
You can't destroy the indestructible ring.
Can you make its owner sacrifice it? Can you also other magic jokes that Beth evidently doesn't quite get?
Shit. But yeah, I think, generally refer to the player manual and cast spell times and stuff like that
Yeah,
otherwise.
that's kind of the like overall conclusion of this episode. I think it's gonna be that.
Yeah.
What's that? What else?
Who can use magic?
Anyone already said this. People just sort of often don't because it frightens them.
As I've said, if you were born with the disposition to cast magic, if you have the magic gene, you can cast magic, regardless of your race or anything like that. Though there are various taboos about certain members of certain races learning magic, like male elves, generally are forbidden from learning magic because elves, cultural stuff, whatever. You know. Yeah. But yeah. Generally the answer is anyone, isn't it, really? If you put playing D&D, it's like, well, it's unfair to put restrictions on who wants to be a wizard or not, and generally you
Well,
don't.
I think it's like anybody can play a magical character, but
Yeah.
that's different to any character could be a magical character.
Yeah.
So,
Yeah.
I mean, like in your game, we might want to go down the Mass Effect route, in that regardless of who is a magic user, technically everybody starts being one of the lucky 20%.
Yeah.
Which is, by the way, for those who don't know, the official explanation for why you can reclass into a biotic in like the rebuilds in Mass Effect 2 and 3 character creation, even if you were not those things before. It's because Shepard is always biotic. It's just sometimes they don't really do anything about that, and they don't get
Yeah.
an amp or anything.
Yeah. Like, I think that's probably like you were like dormantly 20%, and then, 'cause I mean, here's the thing. If you're one of the lucky 20% who can cast magic, a magic school has probably found you and offered you to go to school. Like, and odds are you probably took them up on that opportunity because you were probably poor as fuck or you come from a magical family. Like, there aren't, you know, but maybe you didn't. Maybe you were like, oh, I don't know, my grandmother's ill and I have, you know, and I've got to work on my dad's farm.
I can't
I don't.
afford to pay tuition fees.
Yeah. I mean, there aren't any tuition fees in Mage School, it's free.
Truly, this is a fantasy universe.
No, yeah. Like, you're gonna interact with, like, my government and how effective it is, and you're gonna be like, wow, Beth, this is, like, your dream world, isn't it? And I'm gonna be like, yeah,
I
effective
bet
government.
nobody's a shit to the poor in your world. Oh no.
Maybe, I don't know. Some people are a shit to the poor, but not everyone. Not the king. The king's down with the poor.
Not, of course, that we condemn any of this stuff we're talking about. You know, we've mentioned before that if you want to make a world set to specifications to remove all the things that you dislike enough to not really want to tell stories about them, that's fine.
Yeah,
My
like
world doesn't have any rape or slavery in it.
neither does like mine doesn't have like rape is like a serious fucking crime in my world that actually faces consequences.
So daring.
So daring.
So, like, what else? Because that was kind of a non-starter of a question, as I remember.
Yeah. How do others react to magic?
Well, a lot of people are scared of it.
Mm.
Generally, I don't know what the equivalent magical phrase for can you fix my computer is, but if you encounter a mage and you are not personally a mage, that's probably the first thing that you're going to ask because you're terrible.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's like, can you magically do my dishes or some shit?
Yeah.
Like, magic is a skill, just like any other skill, and it's a skill that because everybody can learn it, there's a different kind of relationship. It's not an ivory tower or, like, chosen race kind of relationship. It's like, this is a vocation that some people have. It's a pretty cool vocation at times, but it also requires a lot of in-depth study that I'm kind of intimidated by. So a lot of people, I think, will kind of like, especially if they're old people, will try and pretend not to understand it, just so that they don't really have to deal with interacting with it that much.
I think in 2Earth, like, there are parts of the world where it's like, whoa, magic. That's scary because you can basically, like, destroy a lot of stuff and you have, like, all this power at your fingertips, essentially. Like, literally. But, like, the majority of people are like, oh, yeah, mages, they're awesome. Like, they can, like, heal you with diseases. They defend your village with their fireballs. They're super lovely and educated, and they have this real sense of duty and responsibility. Man, mages are great. Magic is generally something that's seen as pretty cool and accepted and awesome. It gets the respect that scientists in this world probably should. You know, it's seen as like a really good thing to be is being magic. And you're considered incredibly lucky if you are one, and yeah. Great. I mean, maybe there are people in this world who've had bad experiences with magic, definitely. and that's sort of maybe coloured their perception of magical people. Anybody who has lived under a curse, or like a lifelong family curse that's followed you, like there is one family that the players are going to interact with quite strongly, and their curse is that like they will only ever have one child. It doesn't matter how many children that they've managed to have, they'll only ever raise one child to adulthood, which is really tragic. And so that's coloured that family's perception of magic quite a bit, as you can imagine, because they've had to live under this horrible curse. And most of the nobility in Two Earth are under some sort of horrendous curse because, noble families piss off people sometimes and cause grudges. What do you do? Let's get a witch to curse them. So maybe that's color depending on the severity of the curse, it depends. So the Harper family who rules the city of Cranzenfort are a bit wary of magic because one way or another they believe that it's killed all their children.
Makes sense,
Yeah.
would colour your opinion on it?
Yeah. Whereas, if you're Lord Redmayne, it's just made you ginger and all your children ginger. And he quite likes being ginger.
It's his personal brand.
Yeah. And he's like, my name wouldn't make sense if I wasn't ginger, would it?
Go on. What's
The last one.
Oh, the last one.
The last one. Why haven't people with this power taken over the world?
Apathy and fear. I keep harping on this, it's the main reason. Or, depending on your perspective, they have. That's a lot of people who use magic are incredibly powerful and command a large amount of monetary or social power because of it, but also a lot of people who aren't really that savvy about magic just carry on just fine because there isn't really a high enough population of people who can be bothered to give a shit to actually make a difference. Also, the more powerful and the more complicated the magic you make is, the more universal the consequences of getting it wrong become. So there's a huge amount of code review that would have to go into properly powerful magic, which limits the real time and power available to very, very powerful wizards who are inventing new spells all the time. So they generally do it for academic pursuit, whereas actually powerful magicians tend to satisfy themselves with medium to low level high tier spells, which are limited in what they can do when standing up to just like the power of, say, sheer force of numbers, or the very strong likelihood of a mage of equivalent power with opposing views. So basically, the fact that mages don't agree in a lot of stuff and magic gets progressively harder the more complicated it is, serve to keep mages in check to a certain extent. As for divine power, nobody's god has got pissed off enough yet, and the old magic is gone. But that's actually the other thing. So if somebody got hold of the old magic in a world where nobody else has the old magic, they could do a serious amount of damage very, very quickly. Also, that is a thing that has happened in the setting, and
Yeah.
the players know about it. That has definitely happened, but it's still limited. In this case, because it turns out if you're an elf and you acquire the power of the old magic after the souring began, that does not mean that the souring goes away in your case. So you end up being basically allergic to yourself and experiencing horrible chronic pain from your body constantly rebelling against the power inside you, which really limits your ability to do a large number of things. But it could happen.
In Two Earth, it's entirely possible for someone of great power, but you'd have to be incredibly powerful. And in fact, there is a villain who has tried this. But the problem is, there is always going to be a mage on the opposite side of you who is just as strong as you. This is the thing with magic. There's always someone better, or there's always someone equally matched.
Yeah, mages taking over the world really needs to involve the large majority of mages agreeing on doing that.
Yeah,
And that's
like,
not the case in a lot of settings
yeah.
where that hasn't already happened.
You would have to firstly be a really powerful mage. Secondly, get power from another source that isn't just pure magic. You'd either have to bargain with the fae, you'd have to make some sort of deal with a demon or a god. So in theory, a warlock could do it, but it would need to be explicitly they would need to take over the want to take over the world. But again, that amount of power, you know, against similarly a group of similarly powered mages, that isn't always going to work out. And you know, as well, the more powerful you are a magic user in this setting, the more the Fae take a really deep, intense interest in you and want to play with you. And that is not a thing you want to happen as a magic user.
So getting fucked with by the Fae is like the white blood cells of magic, right?
Yeah, like they'll be like, "Oh, you're very powerful. Why don't you come play with us in the Fae world?" And basically kidnap you into the Fae plane, where you will be their favorite dolly forever and ever and ever. You know, and like the Fae are way more powerful than you. And you know, like no, it doesn't matter if you're like a level 20 power word kill wizard.
There are going to be at least some Fae who are more powerful than you.
There are all Fae are more powerful than you.
Fair.
Like maybe with the exception of like Lashae, obviously, who you can fight, but like you know, Fae are basically eldritch gods. Like they could, you know, if Fae really wanted to, they could fucking kill everyone if they really wanted to. The only thing that stops them is the fact that they don't want to do that at the minute.
Yeah.
So really, the real question is why have the Fae haven't taken over the world yet? And their answer would be, just don't feel like it. You know, but essentially for mages, it's, I mean,
There's a
they've
cap
tried,
limit on
it's just
power.
never went well.
So what would you say in Tuath the most magically powerful like beings that can be templated off a player character race are?
Can you say the question again? It didn't quite
Well,
go in.
you implied that it was probably warlocks. I mean, in terms of like things that a player character could conceivably become, what is the most powerful magical being?
An ascendant.
An ascendant?
You would have to curry the favor of a god, and they would have to make you a god, essentially. That is totally a thing that can happen.
That's pretty close to mine. I would say in Dawnsombra it's either avatars or interdimensionals.
Yeah.
And obviously, because interdimensionals don't exist at the start of the campaign, they have to actually be like the first one. The campaign I run on Tuesdays, there definitely is one, and it's an ex-player character. And I would say because of their ability to plane shift at will, and the fact that they aren't beholden to any deities or demonic entities, and they are basically beings fused with incredibly powerful old magic objects, then they are probably the most powerful of that kind of being. If they don't exist, though, and at least competing with them, would be avatars, which are a very limited concept, but it's basically the same sort of deal. It's that like a god selects you, sometimes at birth, sometimes afterwards, depends on the god, to be their avatar, to be like the embodiment of their principle and power in the material world. And indeed, there have only ever been three avatars, and one of them was a dragon. Like, and of the three, it can be conceived that one of them is Tanatha's avatar and is therefore still, like, not alive, but probably undead.
I mean, there
Whereas
are,
the other two are definitely dead.
there are avatars in Tuath as well, but they're not as powerful as ascendants because ascendants are like literally you are a god, like, and an avatar's more like a demigod, if that makes sense. You are the manifestation of a
Well, yeah,
certain
avatars are kind
aspect
of
of a god.
demigods. I have considered the idea that a being might be able to ascend to become a god in Dawnsombra, but that has never happened.
Yeah, but you know.
I've considered that there are deity niches that haven't been filled, so it's possible that like a level 20 character could conceivably ascend to become a god under some exceptional circumstances.
Yeah.
But I don't think I've ever allowed it to happen before, and I don't see why I'm going to allow it to happen. Like, I'd have to have a much more unified world, I think,
Yeah.
where that player would then become that god, just be that god.
Yeah. I think to become an ascendant, you would need to experience first-hand work by the gods, essentially, which isn't something like the gods walk around and interact with people, but very rarely do they actually use their godly powers in front of
Oh,
people.
shit, I completely forgot. The Relendian gods are technically not sapient beings, but they do like they're basically demigods,
Yeah.
but they have this philosophy where as far as they're concerned, calling an exoplanar being a god is nonsense. Like, it just doesn't make any sense. It's like a complete contradiction in terms, because they believe that godhood comes with inherent responsibilities to the people that you are a god over that cannot be fulfilled if you do not exist in the same plane as those beings. So they're like, well, if you live in your own plane of existence, separate from the material world, you just emphatically are not a god. You cannot ever be a god unless you come to the material world. So, because they're like actually interactable with in the material world and they have supreme godlike power, they are probably, I'd say one could go toe to toe with an avatar, and the fact that none ever have is probably good, because it would probably be pretty huge. I think against an interdimensional, they would probably lose, though, just because the interdimensional will be able to get the drop on them.
I think the only thing really you could compare to like an ascendant into Earth would be like a wizard powerful enough to travel to parallel universes, but also be a big enough of a scientist so that they could time travel. Like that would be the only contender for like most powerful being.
Oh, Sarkhan
So,
Vol then.
pardon?
Sarkhan Vol then.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, if you figure out how to time travel into Earth and you can travel to parallel universes a
Yeah.
bit, you can, you're about
Probably.
there.
I find it really weird that we've done a whole episode on magic and not talked about mage, as in White Wolf's mage. But
Yeah.
I don't really know what there is to say about mage other than, hey, check out mage. Either
Check out Mage.
old world, World of Darkness, or New World of Darkness. It doesn't particularly matter. I think that the system works in a comparable way each time. But there you can find like a lot of the different ways that magic can be modeled laid out in the same universe, competing with each other. And it's a pretty cool system for encapsulating the entire discussion we've been having here about like how magic can be modeled, I think.
I mean, we've just been discussing our worlds and how magic pertains in them, but it shows you the many different ideas and the different sort of opposing sides, maybe even to have that you can do with magic. You have Alex's very stuff that's based on coding and stuff like that, and you have mine, which is based on birthright and mystical bullshit.
Yeah, and I think that comes from like what we want,
Yeah.
comparatively. Like, this is the thing I know, and I want a magic that is based on proactive attempts to learn a craft. Whereas to you, magic is a bit more mystical, and there's a lot less responsibility put on the magic user in particular to try and harness this force, which is available only. It makes you special, really, which is a thing that, my system doesn't really have,
I
except
mean,
in specific cases.
I've kind of completely forgot about rangers and their ability to use magic, but the reason why they can use magic is different to the reasons why other people can use magic, because they get their magic from a powerful being that they've had a connection with, like a dragon or a fox spirit or like a really powerful mythical creature,
So
and
like
is.
a patron, but with no obligation to like sell your soul or anything.
No. You're in a weird way, you're kind of its familiar, if that makes sense.
Huh,
But
yeah,
without
makes
the,
sense.
like obligations, therefore, I mean, if you've got a dragon as your patron animal, you might want to be nice to dragons.
That's pretty much how I model like warlocks whose patron is an interdimensional. Like, interdimensionals are so pants-shittingly powerful and exist in the exoplanes in like such, they're so completely removed from their previous lives as normal sapient beings. If you have one as your patron, they probably don't know you exist. You're just sort of siphoning off their power, which is coming through at a massive amplifying multiplier through exoplanar space, so they don't really even notice. So that, oh, there's no obligation to be selling your soul then. That's good.
And I think with bards, I did a kind of metaphor for people who are different at learning things. Like bards essentially are a massive metaphor for like people with like dyslexia and dyscalculia and autism and dyspraxia in my universe. They're neuroatypical. They learn magic differently. And
Big
so
fan.
And so they do magic differently, and mages don't really consider them proper mages, but they know they're mages. They're just mages that sing and dance and play instruments, you know?
Nice. I love it.
Yeah.
I think we've covered that pretty extensively. It was a nice structure to have the questions
I think
right
it was,
there.
yeah.
So if you give me that link after we finish recording, then I will stick it up in the description so that everybody can go and check it out if you can't remember what the questions were.
Yeah, to listeners, I would just suggest read lots and lots of fantasy books and have a look at how, and watch fantasy TV series and watch movies set in fantasy universes and observe how magic works in that
Yeah,
universe.
the question you have to be asking yourself all the way through that is how, if at all, does this system limit the power available to its powerful beings?
Yeah.
Hell, you could even play other games. I made a lot of references to Magic the Gathering this podcast, mostly to confuse Beth, but
Yep.
actually, the mana system in Magic the Gathering is a means by which the power of magical beings is restricted.
Yeah.
And there's a whole load of other games where, like, that's the case, like board games and video games and all of that stuff. Just go and consume that, and you will have ideas about how magic can work.
And maybe you've got a really clear idea of what magic's like in your universe, and that will be really cool. Magic's a really fun topic to talk about because you can go so many places, but we've had a very structured episode about world building, and we've talked a bit about our worlds as well, which I think is always good.
Yeah, I think this is the first time that Beth has mentioned 2Earth,
Yeah,
so that's
I
fun.
didn't really come up before, but yeah.
Yeah, it's good. I've known about this for quite a while, but just recently Beth has started to want to run a game in it, so that's going to be really fun. Of
Yeah.
course, I think when we actually start that, we can probably switch roles for a bit. You know,
Yeah.
if you want to talk about like DM stuff, and then I'll be a player in your game, so I'll be able to
Yeah,
talk
be
about
really
other stuff.
fun, yeah. Yeah, I think we've came to a natural conclusion on this podcast. So
Okay. Well, this was House of Bards. Your hosts were Alex.
and Beth.
The music is by Kevin MacLeod, and I haven't decided at this point in recording what the image is going to be, so you'll find it in the description, probably. Unless it's like actually in the public domain, in which case I might not bother. But you know how to like. Well, actually, reverse googling a video thumbnail is probably not going to be very helpful. I'll put it in the description. So that I think is everything for this week.
If you need to contact us,
Oh
I'm
yes.
Baroness Bamf on Twitter and on Tumblr.
And I am Cleaver Crummish. That is Cleaver Crumbish on Twitter and Tumblr.
And if you want to make stuff for us, if you just hashtag it House of Bards, whether that be on all one word or three words
If
if
you're
you're
on
on Tumblr.
Twitter, yeah, if you're on Twitter, you can make it all one word. On Tumblr, I look at the tag for just three words. It doesn't really matter how you capitalize it. I will probably see it. If it's on Twitter, then I think Beth checks that one more often. But anything like that, you can send it to us. If you have some ideas about what you think would be a really cool way for magic to work in a setting, I at least would love to hear about them. And if you
I'd love to
have,
hear about them as well,
like,
yeah.
recommendations for series with really interesting ways to that make interesting ways to handle magic. I personally prefer very very magic heavy settings, but if there's a particularly cool very magic light one you want to recommend to us, that's fine. If you have any ideas for future topics for the podcast, then we absolutely would love to hear those because we do have like kind of a roadmap set up, but
We're running out.
we're
Please
very
help.
quickly running through topics. Like, that we could talk about. So yes, that was the podcast, and we will. I don't know when I'm going to upload this. I really, really hope it's earlier than the Wednesday that the previous one went up because I went to see my folks and I did not get the editing done because I'm terrible. So I hope this one goes up earlier and that therefore I can say that we will see you next week.
Bye.
Bye. film I was thinking of is called The Lazarus Effect, and it came out on February the 27th, 2015.
Right.
It does star Olivia Wilde and Donald Glover
Right.
and another load of people I haven't heard of, and it's made by the producer of The Purge.
Right, okay.
So I don't actually
The
expect it to
Purge.
be very good.
Interesting concept. I like the two lead actors, but
Well,
maybe
they're not two lead actors. I think Donald Glover has a bit part. The
I.
other lead is Mark Duplass, who I have never heard of.
I've never heard of Mark Duplass.